Joining me tonight is a good friend, Aaron Peters, and he is the high school pastor at Main Campus. And so Aaron and I talk often and believe that technology and social media is a prevalent issue. And so I'd like to just sort of start with the Bible and kind of let that be a little bit of the framework, but we'll jump practical. But Paul writes in Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, Paul's talking to the church at Colossae, and he basically is giving them a strong admonition. He says, "See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ." And so Paul gives this strong stance to us that, see to it, make sure that no one takes you captive. Now, obviously, Paul's writing to a church that didn't have social media or technology, but some of those same spirits and some of those same strongholds that existed then exist now and often show themselves in the form of entertainment, things that are on the screen. And so I believe that we, who have the responsibility of shepherding this next generation, be educated, that we go from being on the defensive to the offensive, and that we know what's facing our children, and that we wouldn't let our children educate us, but we would instead educate ourselves so that we can be adequately prepared. How many of you remember this? Dial-up internet. Yep, I used to love getting those AOL CDs in the mail. My family had dial-up internet when I was in college. Everybody was, you know, big time having Roadrunner, and I was sitting there, you know that sound. Still remember that sound. What about this? Actually calling somebody. Look at that big phone. That's a huge phone. What about one of these? The church I came from still used the fax machines. Anybody ever use a fax machine? All right. What about this? Handwritten letters. Lost art. Love getting handwritten letters. And then, I mean, who uses these anymore? Wires. You right? Everything's wireless. Wires are absolutely going away. But this really hit home to me when we had Emmy. And this picture is of Emmy, I mean, just learning to basically stand up and already knows how to start working on a computer. And then it hit home again when our youngest, we handed her a toy and it had a picture on it, and she starts swiping it. I'm like, well, I mean, it's just technology, social media, smartphones are just embedded in our culture. And so what your children are, what my children are called digital natives. Your child is a digital native. They are the first generation to grow up in a digital world. They live the majority of their lives based on the internet. So social media, it's an outlet of expression. It's an outlet to complain about their parents. It's a place to go and complain. It's also a place to connect for many students. So due to the rapid growth and basically the brevity of time that we have to fully sort of adjust to this change, we have a greater responsibility than ever. And so I want to give you just a little bit of overview. You have notes in front of you that we'd love for you to kind of go through with us. And so first, just look at the overview of social media. We're talking about technology, a lot of it's social media. If you don't have a handout, we can send one around to you. But if you think about the history of social media, what would you say is the first kind of thing put in place that would, social media-wise? Anybody know?
MySpace.
MySpace, way back then. Anybody have a MySpace account?
Zanga.
Zanga, yeah. Friendster, you know, there's all sorts of things. I mean, you could go back, man, the birth of the, like, post office, right? I mean, it sort of started that 550 BC, is what most people think, just sort of connected people. But really recently, with like MySpace and Friendster and then the Facebook, and then now they got cool, they dropped the, became this place and this outlet that really made our world globalized. That in an instant you could communicate with somebody in your from your bedroom in Charlotte, North Carolina, somebody all the way around the world. So it sounds really cool, but remember what Paul said, see to it that no one takes you captive. And so looking at, thinking of the current landscape of social media, Snapchat, anybody have a kid with Snapchat or do you have Snapchat? When I used to do this talk a long time ago, I would say, don't let your kid have Snapchat. I still believe that, by the way. Don't hold me to it. I would just say, I don't like it. I'd say, take it off. But anyway, Snapchat is the fastest growing social network among U.S. teens. So look at Snapchat. You can kind of see some of the major social media outlets that show the rapid growth. Snapchat really has been the fastest growing one. In fact, what do you think is losing popularity? And why? Parents are on it. You guys messed up their world. All right? You're on it. So when you think that it's cool, they're gone. They'll still be your friend because they don't want to get in trouble, because you probably said, well, you got to be my friend if you're going to have Facebook. But, right, so Snapchat, the danger of Snapchat is that if you don't know what Snapchat is, you can post a picture and it erases. And it actually started with as a sexting app for college students. So see to it that no one takes you captive. And so that's the current landscape. And so I listed, and I'm not going to go through all these, but I think it's really important. I listed probably 16 or 17, 18 apps that you should know. And I want to just briefly mention a few of them. The first one is actually number one here. It's called WhatsApp. Anybody heard of WhatsApp or have WhatsApp? How many of you check your kids' text messages or look through their text message every once in a while? Right? Accountability. Well, WhatsApp is an app that allows them to message people all over the world. So it can be a really good thing if you know people who are missionaries. A lot of missionaries use WhatsApp. But WhatsApp is an app that is connected to Facebook that you can message people. And so you may think you're looking at your kids' text messages, but they're probably not using their message app that's built into their phone that Apple has designed, or Android, but they're using WhatsApp. Because you're like, what's that? You know, WhatsApp? I don't know. So that's so it's available on all platforms. So let's say, look, see if kid has WhatsApp. Number five is Snapchat. I've already made my pitch about Snapchat. Again, you know, it says it deletes. Nothing ever goes away when you put it on the internet. Snapchat, if you read all the fine print embedded in there, they store your videos. I mean, by law, with the government, they're storing your videos, so nothing ever goes away. So Snapchat really is, it can be a place for students and kids to share inappropriate pictures or videos of themselves. And the thing that you think it's going to go away, but there's a special feature on an iPhone that you just hit two buttons and you take a screenshot. And so I've heard countless stories of teenage girls thinking that they're sending pictures of themselves that they don't think anybody else is going to see, that some guy, middle school boy, will screenshot and share with hundreds of their friends. And so I would say Snapchat, with a preteen or teenage brain, really, they can't handle it. Again, anything that you want to put out that would disappear, maybe you shouldn't put out anyways. So there's a bunch of other apps. I would encourage you, look over these, go home in a nice way. Ask to see your kid's phone to see if they have any of these apps, and you can read about them. A couple more I'd like to mention is number 15, ask.fm. How many of you have heard of that? Okay, ask.fm. It's a social media site that allows users to post a series of questions that they put out on the World Wide Web, then for people that they don't even know to answer about them. So A 12-year-old girl goes shopping with her mom, buys a new outfit, goes to the dressing room, tries it on, takes a selfie, puts it on Ask FM. Do you think I look cute tonight in my new outfit? 12-year-old girl. You're going to get some people say, yeah, you look absolutely pretty. But what do you think some people are going to say? And so it begins to become this place where you ask questions and you want someone to validate your identity and find your identity in these questions that you're posing to complete strangers. And so Ask.fm has been the source of when people have done research among teens who have committed suicide, they can trace it back a lot of times to Ask.fm because their identity gets so wrapped up in what people say about them and these questions that they ask. Next is Poof. Now, this is a scary one. This is number 16 here. Poof. This app allows users to make other apps disappear. So they can download an app and then download Poof, and then you can actually look at their phone and not even be able to tell that it's there. So there's an app that looks like the calculator app on your phone. It really isn't a calculator. It's a messaging platform. So Poof is there. Then Tinder. Tinder is an app that's basically just used for dating and hookups. It's really popular among millennials, but it's infiltrated down into middle schoolers and high schoolers. So you can basically create a profile that's synced up to GPS, so you can pull up your phone and you can see other Tinder users, and you can pull up their picture and swipe to the left or to the right. One swipe one way means that you don't like them, and the other swipe the other way means that you do like them. And it generates all these things. And so teens have started using this as sort of a hookup platform. So I think these apps are important for you to know and to educate yourself, and new apps come out all the time because you guys get in their world, which is good. But it's important because, you know, I've done a breakout like this for 3 or 4 years, and every 6 months there's a new app that has gained in popularity. So Snapchat, Instagram, Poof, Ask.fm, I think are websites and apps that you should know about. Now, you may not think that this is really important. I'm sure you do because you're in this breakout. But technology, the third point is that technology really is fundamental to society. So if you take a look at this slide, you can see social media, just usage from people. Snapchat, again, is one of the hottest ones, spring 2015, spring 2016. So you can kind of see usage based on where teens are. The majority of them are going to be on Snapchat. Instagram's hanging pretty high, although it's dropped some. But again, Snapchat. So if you look at that, it's just good to know kind of where students are, so the up and down, the trends, where they're at. If they have, again, Google, we probably all adults spend a lot of time on Google. They're not Googling things anymore. They're looking to their friends to tell them information about the world. So here's some important statistics. 24% of teens go online almost constantly. How many of you have been able to get through a meal without your kid looking at their phone or looking at the TV or being interrupted? I think the most recent stat that I heard is the average person can go about 14 seconds without feeling the need. Like 14 seconds, if it's silent, the natural impulse is, well, let me take out my phone and look at it and see what's going on. 14 seconds. 92% of teens go online daily. Now, some are going to argue, well, my kids have to go online for school. My kids have to go online, which is true. I mean, schools really do require you to go online, but that just means constant exposure to being online. Some 93% of teens ages 12 to 17 are online, meaning they have either a profile or there is something about them out on the digital world that will never go away. I think that's really important to communicate to kids. Again, anything you post will not go away. And so they are online. The average teen sends 3,339 texts per month. It's a lot. Teen females send an incredible 4,050 texts per month, while teen males send an average of 2,539 texts per month. You should go look and compare that to yourself. And I'm pretty sure theirs is a lot higher than yours. 70% of teens have access to a smartphone. Just by show of hands, how many of your kids have access to a smartphone? All right. How many of your kids don't own a smartphone? Okay. Which is good. So smartphones really can make you dumb, especially teens. But remember that if kids have access to your phone, that's the stat, that they have access to a smartphone, not necessarily owning a smartphone, but I think that should be a decision that you make as a family. My recommendation is that a kid shouldn't have a smartphone at least until they're sophomore, junior in high school. I mean, we'll have students come in and student ministry that have already had phones since they were like fourth or fifth grade. I just think it's putting way too much power in the hands of an undeveloped brain. And if we're to guard, protect the hearts of our children, I think that we've got to be mindful and commit this before the Lord and not just take it lightly, especially just because they're going to say, well, so-and-so has it, their parents let them have it, and it's easy to fall into that because it's not that much more money at the end of the day. So I think be mindful of that. 69% of teens have their own computer. 27% of teens use their phone to get online. 73% of teens are on a social network. And it's not that they're just on a social network, but just think of Facebook. 86% of social networking using teens comment on friends' walls. So that means they're engaged on social media. They're looking to comment or for people to comment on their posts. Nobody posts a picture on Instagram and doesn't want somebody to double-click it. And so their identity is now being found in how many likes they get or who comments on their Facebook wall. 66% send private messages to friends on a social media, whether it's direct message through Instagram or direct message through Snapchat, that they're sending private messages. 52% send group messages. So these aren't just one-to-one communication. This is multiple levels of communication. Then 83% comment on photos. So on Instagram, they're commenting on photos. And then Facebook, Snapchat, Twitter, and Instagram are just as fundamental to society as radio and TV and movies were in our generation. And so it is absolutely fundamental. How many of your kids, especially if you have boys, play video games? All right. 50% of boys and 25% of girls spend an average of more than 42 hours per week in front of electronic screens. That's a lot of hours. And this is taken from 7th grade students. So a screen, and it's possible, if you think about it, that in 1 hour of time, you could technically log 3 hours of screen time. And the way that you do that is, some of us may be guilty in this room, is the TV's on, your phone is on, a computer is on. That's 3 hours of screen time in 1 hour of actual time. And so time can add up pretty quick. And so I think one of the ways as parents, and Aaron will touch on this, is we can model the way that we spend our screen time. Now, video games. 88% of young people play video games. And statistics show that 8.5% of American youth show signs of addictive behavior when it comes to video games. You may have experienced this, that, you know, if you go travel and you're in the car and they start going through withdrawals because they have to have a phone or they have to have an iPad or they have to have their Xbox. Not only do you have to pack a whole bunch of stuff to go to the beach or to grandma's house, but you have to pack the Xbox now or make sure that they have an Xbox. And so this screen culture, this digital world, is fundamental to society. And so I hope that provides you with an overview. Now, Aaron's going to come up and talk a little bit about some guardrails we can put in place and some practical things that we can do about this. So welcome, Aaron.
As Roper mentioned, my name is Aaron Peters. I have the privilege of serving on staff at our main campus. I've been there for 6 years. I started as an intern, and I wish my wife could be here tonight. She's not feeling well. She has a virus. I know it's on the web. Sorry, sweetie. I know you can see this. She's not feeling well. She wishes she could be here tonight. But I want to step back just for a minute as we get started with this second practical half. If you're like me and you hear some of these stats, you might be overwhelmed, maybe discouraged. There might be a sense of, man, I'm a failure. I didn't know these apps were out there. And you can feel really overwhelmed. But our goal is not to make you feel afraid, but it's to make you aware that a lot of these students, and we'll talk about a couple stats, but they're learning some things that we'd rather have them learn in your home or in church, but they're learning them on the web. And so part of our job and our belief is that you are the primary disciplers in their life. But sometimes what happens just with busyness is that the phone, technology, and other teenagers become the main disciplers in your student's life. So before we get started with this section, I want to remind us, with social media, the main thing behind there, like Justin Roper mentioned, is this sense of self-worth. And that's not something new to this day and age. For us, it might be our business, or sometimes it could be car or possessions, give us a sense of worth. Well, these students are finding it in pictures of themselves, or how many likes that they get, or if someone will log on to their YouTube page and subscribe. Well, more than all of this, what we can do as parents or students or disciplers, if we can help them understand the gospel, that in Jesus Christ, he has given us his righteousness, which gives us a worth, an importance, and a value. And students are searching for that. And it's more than just you telling them you love them and care for them. It's them understanding at a deep level that they don't need to have more followers than someone else to have a sense of worth. If they can understand and we can teach them from a discipleship level that Jesus died to remove the shame and the guilt or the failure that you may feel as a student, but that Jesus' life gives them the worth, the righteousness, and the meaning to live, then that helps promote what they're looking for. So sort of as that as a headline, I want to begin looking at the fourth section. Social media can create a false sense of connection. You know, Facebook, raise your hand if you're on Facebook. I'm not saying this is like, let's call each other sin. I'm not saying that. But Facebook was designed in order to have connections with people. To say, hey, I know this person. I can send them a quick message and then meet up. What's interesting now, social media that was designed to connect people socially is actually causing them to disconnect from someone in the physical. And so if you look at here, I'll just briefly walk through some of these. You probably notice this at your house. When were growing up, it might have been everyone was around the dinner table, and there maybe you didn't have a TV in your living room or in the kitchen. And now, like Justin Roper mentioned, that they have it on their phone, they're looking at it, and it's causing this sort of disconnect at family meals or car rides that used to be, when you were a kid, it used to be just you talking to mom or dad. And now it's the kids on the phone, you have the radio on, and it begins to kind of drown everything out. You see it in their friendships. When you and I growing up, it might have been the sports field or the classroom. Well, now they're logging on to chat sites, or they'll get a text message from a friend, and now friendships aren't face-to-face, but they're on the internet. And so friendships are really surface value, and we're going to see more of that as time goes on because it's only what's happening socially. So kids can even be in a room together. You've probably seen this at a sleepover at your house or something, that they're in a text message group and they're talking in the group while they're texting other people in the group. But interesting, if you look at point C and D, what this creates is the student feels sort of invisible and isolated. So something that's supposed to create a social platform has now created them feel isolated, and they look at everyone else's highlight reels on Instagram. They look at their own life, and they're like, I don't have that. I'm not as good as it. I don't look as good. And what it does is it forces them to go deeper into the internet world. And now they're looking at, well, I want to look like her, and I'll click this page, or I'll Pinterest that, or I'll take a screenshot of this. And that's beginning to create the world that they want to live in. And so now they're caught in this, and it's on their phone. And now they're caught looking for self-image, and it's creating a cycle of them feeling isolated even deeper in it. So I know I sort of have the negative start. My end is good, I promise, okay? But let's go to the deepest part of depravity here, and then we'll work our way out, okay? But here's some dangers of social media. We might not think of it, but there's a lot of bullying going on. I've got students in my office, believe it or not, that come pretty frequently, and they're deeply wounded when they were unfriended or they were blocked. Because it was basically like them being socially outcast in front of other people. And they're like, oh, my gosh, you were blocked from Susie's Instagram. Like, how do you feel about that? And it's like this ultimate shun. Or they'll post things about each other or take pictures in the classroom of someone else. They'll take a picture, send it to somebody else. And now that circulates faster than any rumor when we were in school. And now that's getting out there. And so it forces students to go even deeper into this cyber world to get a sense of worth. Ultimately, because they don't understand the worth of Jesus and the righteousness that was given to them. So if I got a stat here, it's interesting. Point number one, says research suggests that 30% of young people report being victims of electronic aggression. That could be an emoji of a middle finger. That could be an explicit of being said at them. It could be some sort of inappropriate picture or whatever it is, but 30% of our students, of your children, are having some sort of either aggressive conversation or someone's being said something that's unkind or hateful towards them, and the way they deal with it is not to talk to you. The way they deal with it is just go deeper in the cyber world looking for worth. Another stat, number three here. By the age of 18, the average American will have viewed over 200,000 acts of violence just on TV alone. So I know we could talk about video games here in a moment, and just a kind of disclaimer, I would recommend if your student is playing video games, it's not just the ones that you maybe buy from the store, but it's maybe the apps on their phone that may say things that are ungodly and are sort of this promoting this way of speech in life. So I'd really recommend you guys to really look at the ratings and see what is your student looking at. So that's sort of cyberbullying. Move into... something a little bit more serious that's really going on in our culture is this expression of sexual intimacy. Look at number two here. Young teens, this is 13 to 15-year-old, rank entertainment media as the top source of information about sexuality. That means the seventh grade health class isn't the classroom anymore in school to learn about sex. Sometimes it's not even at home they're learning about it. Now they're learning sex because they're watching it on their phone. Or they're hearing about it from a friend who sent them a link to a video, and now they can just click on it from a text message. You look at some even scarier stats. We'll jump down to posting pictures and work our way back up. It just helps in the same flow. In a college survey, under letter D here, in a college survey, more than 80% of men, and more than 50% of women said that they were exposed to pornography by age 14. There's even a statistic that says that the majority of students that are seeing pornography for the first time are in third grade. They're 7 years old, 8 years old, is the first experience they're having. It might be a sleepover, is how it sort of used to be. Or it used to be a father's magazine. But now we're seeing it's a friend's phone. It's what they just accidentally clicked on, or a pop-up ad that was on a game that was innocent, but now they're promoting something else that's on your child's iPad, and they can just see it right there and click on it, and then they've entered into a world that you and I might not be aware of. Moving back up to number four of letter B. 25% of the commercials that are on TV, and you can even hear on the radio, or if you even have Spotify and you don't buy Spotify, which is like the, it's a good music app, or if you just sort of download it and then not buy a copy, there's a lot of like impure commercials that are going on through Spotify. 25% of the commercials include some sort of sexual innuendo or explicit sexual content. Man, this is just a depressing part of this, guys. Hang in there. It gets better. Just want to make you aware of this because we love you, care for you. This is not one that we're excited to talk about, but we want to make sure you're aware. Places like Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter are places that predators will go to see information about any sort of person. 55% of teens have given their personal info to someone they do not know, including photos and physical descriptions. If we're honest, sometimes we can click on, even in our student ministry, you know what school they go to, you have their cell phone number, you have their email, and you know where they've been. It's got a, we go to this place, and it has a little description of where they ate that day, and you know their whole world. So if you wanted to follow somebody, if you wanted information about their life, you have it all. And so my goal is not to cause fear, but I want you to know what is your student posting out there that someone else could be aware of as well. Let's move on. Let's jump down past posting pictures. Let's look at self-image. This is especially difficult for our young ladies. It says 80% of girls, 9 through 18, are on diets. That's unreal to think about, even how quick their metabolism is. But 80%, if you look at the stat here that has your blank, 70% of girls say that models influence their idea of a perfect body shape, but even that's a little outdated. They don't need models anymore. It's just their prettier friends on Instagram that creates this envy or a jealousy to be as pretty as that girl or as good-looking as that guy or as muscular as the football player or whatever. And it's creating, like we mentioned, this vortex in this cycle of, man, I need a self-worth. I need to look like this or that to be accepted. Because of this downward spiral under addiction, the digital generation spends more than 70 hours per week online. It's a full-time job for some of these students. Justin mentioned that every 14 seconds there's this desire. It's a social anxiety, actually. You'll see if you look at a group of students, you're in a room, if there's a pause, you go quick for the comfort thing, that you feel like you can be in the world. You reach out your phone, you look at it, and sometimes that can be me too. I'm like, I'm sort of awkward, and I need to look for something. Sometimes it can be a go-to. 70 hours a week, your student's online, and here's some quick math if you're a math person. That equals 3,640 hours or 152 days a year. So that would be almost half of their year on technology. And another way of saying it, that would mean it's 1,062 days from 6th grade through 12th grade. That's all online. This will be the last point under this section. We'll move on to the positive end of the presentation here. Letter G, it says eternal media. These students have a difficult time remembering that these pictures that they post may be deleted from their phone, but it's always out there on the web. And they might not know that. And so part of us sharing this with you is to help educate the student that you or child that you have. So it might be gone off their Facebook or Twitter, but it's on the web. And we would want to think, and something we can help our students, would you want your mom and dad to see this picture? Or would you want your child one day to know that you posted this picture? Some questions like that are helpful. Most importantly, is this picture or is this statement glorifying to God? But sometimes that might not be the helpful statement for your child at this moment. But think through some of those things might be helpful. Well, let's get to the positive end of the spectrum. Well, what do we do? Now we're depressed. We don't have any more kids. We're going to go home and rip off every television and blow up every phone we have. What do we do? I've got a couple practical things for you. I've got 9 here. We'll go through quickly. We'll get done here in about 10 minutes. The first blank for you is move. Not physically, but move a couple things. It used to be when I was growing up, the recommendation was, I'm only 28, the recommendation was, if you have a family computer, put it in the living room, an open spot. Well, now the computer has been minimized to a phone that's in their pocket, and it's in the room every night. Good night, honey. Hope you have a good night. They go to bed. They're with their phone, and now they have thoughts. They've got ideas. They can't sleep, and then here they are. Their babysitter is technology. So I would recommend, maybe it would be a good idea if your student has a computer based on school. If maybe you have like a 9 o'clock or whatever the bedtime rule is, the phone stays downstairs and the computer stays downstairs. That might be a helpful solution. I talked to a lot of young men about the issue of pornography. Just a quick side note, if that's a struggle in your child's life, please talk with them about that. There's a great book called Finally Free. Finally Free, it's by Heath Lambert. He's the counseling professor at Southern Seminary. It's a phenomenal book. But I was talking to a young student recently, and I was recommending him either A, get rid of your phone, B, go to a dumb phone, or C, turn your phone into your parents at night. And his comeback, his kind of backlash was, well, my phone is my alarm clock. And I was like, well, before there was phones, there were things called alarm clocks that I'm sure your parents could afford. If not, please let me know. We'll buy you one. But it's become such a part of life that there's not another way to think about it. And their mom and dads of other friends that they have, their parents won't make them put their phone up. But it's a great way to protect your child and let them sleep. Your child needs 9.5 hours of sleep. You've probably seen that on Fridays and Saturdays and sometimes Sunday mornings you're trying to wake them up. But they need a lot of sleep. And sometimes a phone they're just surfing through, that prevents focus the next day at school and sometimes allows them into some inappropriate things at night. Number two, monitor. Monitor. I would really recommend if you don't, if your child has something like Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, I would recommend either A, become their friend or follower, B, have their password to all their information, and then C, have a conversation about, hey, I love you and I want to trust you, but also I'm your parent and God's designed me to be your shepherd and to watch over your soul. And so part of that is knowing that I'm helping you by having your password and checking in on your social media. I think that's a good conversation to have. So if my parents told me as a kid, I would flip out. Like, that would not go well. But it might be a battle that I believe is worth fighting for. So you could be on the side of the fence of get rid of all social tech or all social media. Praise God if that's you and if that's a battle that you're able to have and win, that's wonderful. If not, get the password, look at what they're doing, and have open, honest conversations about what they're doing and what their friends are doing. Letter three, limit. Limit. Letter B there, I'm just going to read it. It's a good point. Create a few house rules for screen time. Here's just an example we came up with. 1 hour per day, maybe it's of Xbox or television or whether it's just phone time, 1 hour a day, and then maybe none on school nights or only after homework's completed, and then set that time limit and then stick to it. I work with somebody on our staff. Her and her husband are really good. They've got certain times. Their son is young and say, you can only have 1 hour a night to be on this, or I'm only going to give it to you on Saturday for this much time if it's an iPad game. Setting limits are really valuable to do and have that conversation with your student. One of the most important things is the dinner table. I personally don't have children of my own, but was beneficial always growing up. We had to have one meal a day with my family around the table. Like, that was like house rules, and you were like shunned and disciplined if you didn't. So it was either breakfast or dinner. If it was on weekends, it was lunch. That was some of the most valuable time for me as a child, to see my mom and dad interact, to watch my sister and I and have conversations around the table. That might be a good time to limit, saying no phones at the table. TVs are not on at the table. Radios are not on at the table. Nothing's on. People even have radios, right? I think that was an outdated statement. Any of those things, not at the table. That would be a good limit on our time. Number four, that goes right into the next thing, time. Determine clear and established time frames where your students can use their media devices. It might be difficult if your student is in high school, but some of this time thing might be, you know what, let's once a week maybe sit down and just have an honest life conversation. How are you doing spiritually? How are you doing at school? It might be good for us to just take time with our student and have social media be a part of that conversation. Like we mentioned earlier, when the kids go to bed, I really do recommend, because the majority of conversations I have, it's when they're going to bed and they have their phones, is when issues are happening. So that's probably the biggest time recommendation I can have, is set the times, and once it's their bedtime, take the phone, put it in a basket, and then come back and get it the next day when they wake up. Let's move on to the next couple. Balance. I like this one. This was either Justin's idea from the previous year or this current year, but it's interesting. Require 30 minutes of physical activity for every 30 minutes of media. That would be a really interesting home discussion. For me, it would have been okay with baseball, but that'd be really interesting. Okay, you go work out, and then I'll give you your phone for how many times you work out. Your kid might end up buff, or they could end up like me. It's up to you. Six, decide. This is interesting. It's the conversations on the way home or when your kid goes to bed tonight that'll set the trajectory for your family. If you're going to, it's helpful to not be ambiguous about rules with screen time. It's good to be decisive. And so maybe for your home, you might need to set up new rules, alter rules, or maybe back down a little from rules. One that would be helpful, I don't know all the technology use of your students, but Netflix is like a huge thing, and they sort of binge watch Netflix or Hulu, and sometimes that's what turns into the weekends for students, especially for college students. There's this TV show I gotta get caught up on, and they watch a whole season in a day or whatever it is. It'd be good for you to decide what are the rules. Something helpful that's just on your sheet is channel surfing. If you've got, we couldn't afford satellite television as a kid, but if you have satellite television, we have every channel known to man. It might be a good idea if you as a parent are setting the TV time, you guys all watch it together or whatever it is, to just choose the TV show comes on this time, I'm going to turn it on for this time, and then once the show's over, it's off, it's done. Being decisive is the most helpful thing for your child, because they're going to watch your habits and replicate them or make them worse. And so be decisive even in your own life. What things are you going to do to make sure that family discipleship is a priority rather than letting entertainment or busyness take the first seat in your family? Seven, restrict. We mentioned this earlier. Not at the table, I think, is the biggest thing. My parents, we had AIM, A-I-M, was like the texting. So all the kids, we'd go home from school, we'd get on the computer, and like that's how we would like text each other. So my rule with my family growing up was, Aaron, get your homework done. Once homework's done, you can get on the computer and you can talk to your friends for 30 minutes. So I was always a reject kid that had to get off. Hey, my mom says I got to get off. But it was beneficial that I didn't become dependent on the computer screen for my interactions. It was helpful if they restricted a certain time. There was a lot of fighting in my house, but I'm standing before you beneficial because mom and dad put their foot down and said, you know what, I'm not going to let technology disciple my son. I'm going to do it, and I'm going to allow some other good influences to do as well. Eight, teach. Teach. Make sure your child understands internet safety. Even sit down with them and talk about some of the apps. Even to sit down and explain, rather than you can't have Facebook or you can't have this, explain why. If you explained why to me as a child, you might have a really strong-willed child. They might say, well, mom and dad, that's just when you were young. People aren't creepy. They don't do this. I understand. I was a strong-willed child. Still, at the same time, what you're saying gets through. And I really would recommend you to spend time teaching about what we taught you. And some of the, he provided, Roper mentioned 15 of the different apps. I would recommend go home and sift through those things and just ask your student, have an honest conversation. Like, mom, I don't think this is that bad. Well, let me show you what could happen. And the goal, again, is not just to say no technology. The goal is how can I be most godly and stay away from sin? That's the conversation. And the last thing is, like teach, it's educate. This is not just educate your child, but we want you to be educated. With the digital generation, there's new apps every day. There's new websites every day. And we want to make sure that you guys are up to date on some of these things. So we would recommend, look at the iTunes top 10 songs and hear what some of the students are listening to when they just say, "Mom, I really like the beat of this song. I don't know what the words are saying." The words are getting through the beat into their heart and into their mind and affecting the way they think about God and others. And so think about some of those things and then stay informed. Ask Justin Roper. He's been helpful for me. Say, "Hey, man, what are the top apps I need to be aware of for my student ministry?" And so it's helpful. So ask a pastor. Look online. There's great sites. Even Kids in Mind is a great movie website to see what are your student watching. "Hey, Mom, I want to go see a movie with my friends," or "Hey, I want to watch this," or you give them the Netflix password and they can look at whatever video. Kids in Mind is a great website. It's just Kids in Mind. It tells you the rating, and if there was profanity, it tells you the exact words that were used, the exact context. It lets you know everything that's available, and that's helpful for you to be educated as a parent. So last two things here, and we'll wrap this up, is to ensure accountability with your child. So we want you to have the conversation, encourage honesty, but then there's some good measures to maybe put on the phone or the computer. Covenant Eyes, raise your hand if your family has maybe some sort of prevention care on the phone. Okay, excellent. I would really recommend that. You can put it on your modem, your routers, your firewalls. That's a letter C there. Open DNS is a really good one. That's a surefire way for something not to break through. But there's always way around it if we don't educate our students about pictures and things with their friends. But Covenant Eyes is good. Be Sure is good. K&I Web Prevention is really good with iPhones, Androids. Safe Eyes Mobile, it costs $15, but this would be a really good investment. So take this home, look at those. And at the end of the day, God has you as a shepherd over your student, and it's worth the battle to take the phone. It's worth the battle to download these, even if your child is not happy with your decision. "Mom, why are you now controlling me? What did those terrible pastors tell you?" It's worth the battle. I'm glad my parents are fighting it and fought it. And I would really encourage you guys to do that. So we'll close with this. Obviously, you can come up and ask us any questions you want at the very end. We'll be hanging around. But the most important thing you can do with your family is to pray with them and to read the Bible. 91% of families don't sit down and pray with their children or read the Bible on a regular basis. That's just people. Just people. So I'd really recommend to have some sort of family discipleship in the home. Maybe it's everyone goes around at dinner time and asks for prayer requests. Maybe before bed you pray with your child, or maybe when you're reading your quiet time to send them, text them and say, "Hey, I read Mark 14 today, and here's a little side note about it, and I'm praying for you." It's the most important thing we can do. So with that in mind, let me read this last passage, and then we'll close in prayer. This is from Deuteronomy chapter 6. Starting in verse 4. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk over them when you sit in the house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they should be the frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on the gates." So more than anything, our hearts is to shepherd your students and help you shepherd your students to love God with all their hearts, minds, and souls. And we believe that with this digital generation, great benefit could happen, but there's a lot of risk, and we want you to be aware of it. And so please come up and ask us any questions. We don't have all the answers, but if any way we can be helpful, please let us know. Thanks, guys, for coming. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your word. That, Lord, this is what changes our hearts and minds. And I pray that the gospel of Jesus, them understanding that the guilt, shame, and how they feel like they've fallen short is an accurate thing. However, Jesus came to die for it. His righteousness that's given to us by faith gives us the worth, the importance, the value that they're searching for. Lord, I pray as our disciples, God, we can come before them and teach them a right self-worth based in the righteousness of Jesus. God, I pray that you'll give us the spiritual empowerment to go home and have these conversations, to sift through apps, to have the difficult conversations about limits and restrictions. God, you'll empower these parents to continue to disciple and love their children well. God, thank you for this time and thank you for this church. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.